Hello everyone. If you're watching this video clip, I sincerely hope that you're all doing well, that you're healthy, and that this message finds you well. I wanted to share just a few thoughts from God's Word that I believe the Holy Spirit has impressed on my heart. And the thoughts come from the book of John in chapter 20. And I know this is a passage that is generally read during Easter. But I felt that the Holy Spirit wanted me to share a few thoughts, especially with our young people at Bethesda Church. From John 20, verse 19 to verse 20. And I just want to read a few verses here. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked down where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. I read this passage and I was thinking to myself, it seems as though the context or the situation that these disciples find themselves in is very similar to the one that we're seeing in our day, in our time. If you read the passage, probably saw that the disciples right after the crucifixion of Jesus were locked into a room. They were behind closed doors and they were afraid. And doesn't that sound similar to our situation today? We're living in a world that is essentially on lockdown. People are in their homes, they're isolated, they're afraid. And many of them are afraid of different things. The disciples were afraid that the Jews might arrest them. Jesus had been crucified, and now they were afraid, and they were locked inside that house. The world in which we live in today, a lot of people are afraid of different things. They're afraid of death. They're afraid of this contamination of the virus. They're also afraid of the economy, the situation in the economy, and what will happen tomorrow. And I believe it's fitting for us to look at this passage and draw from this passage a couple of teachings or a couple of thoughts that could help us along the journey that we're all on. It's not an easy journey. It's a difficult journey. It's one that we're still getting accustomed to, but I believe that the Holy Spirit will help us along. Now, it's interesting that when they're in this room and Jesus appears to them, the Bible says that he came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." It was during a time of great fear, just like our time. And I want to look at what this concept of fear it really is. What does he mean when he says, "Peace be with you"? And I'm reminded of John chapter 14, beginning with verse 27. And in that passage, Jesus actually tells the disciples what this peace is. Entails and what this peace is all about. In verse 27, he says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." So we see that Jesus is actually contrasting between God's form of peace, if you will, and what the world calls peace. We live in a world that is saying, we'll have peace if this virus can be contained. We're living in a world that's saying we can have peace if the situation with the economy settles and it goes back to normal. But what's interesting is that Jesus, when he says, "I leave my peace with you," or "I give you my peace," he says, "I don't give it as the world gives you peace." And so automatically we realize that the peace that Jesus offers his disciples and the peace that he offers us as his people is something totally different than what the world calls peace. And I submit to you this evening that the peace that God gives is not an absence, it's not a taking away of trouble, an absence of calamity or hardship, but rather God's peace is a presence of something. God's peace is literally himself, or the Holy Spirit living in us and producing a feeling of confidence and stillness in our hearts, a quietness in our souls that can go with us. And Jesus says to his disciples, going back to John chapter 20, he says, this to them. Again, let me read the passage. He says, peace be with you. It's as if Jesus is saying, this peace that is a presence, not an absence, but a presence of the Holy Spirit, we'll find in the book of Galatians. This peace is to go with you. It's to be with you wherever you go. And the question for us today is, how can we have this peace? And how can we appropriate this peace in our lives, in our hearts, when times are so turbulent and so difficult? And the answer, I believe, lies in verse 20, where it says that when he had said this, Jesus showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Notice that right after Jesus comments on this concept of peace, he shows them his hands. He shows them the wounds from the cross, from the crucifixion. It's as if Jesus is saying, if you want peace, just look at what I've done for you. And truly, biblically speaking, the peace that we need in our time now is founded, is based, I believe, on what Jesus has accomplished for us on the cross. It's as if Jesus in our time is reminding us and saying, look at what I've already done for you. When he was on the cross, Jesus cried out the words, it is finished. When he died on the cross, he secured salvation for all of us who are his people. And he said, it is finished. And everything that we need now, everything that pertains to life and godliness, as Peter says in one of his epistles, comes forth, has its source, the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, the finished work of Jesus on the cross. And so God is reminding us tonight to look to him, to remember what he has done for us, to remember his wounds, his scars, his finished work, and not only his crucifixion, but his resurrection. The fact that he's alive gives us peace, because we know that he's now at the right hand of the Father, and he is interceding for us. He's there as our advocate, and he is still sovereign and in control. And no matter what happens in the world, as his people, we can have peace. We can rest assured that he is in control of our lives, because he is alive and in glory. And I want to finish off with a couple more thoughts here. And it's this, that during this time that we're in, I've really asked myself personally, and I've, you know, been taking some time to reflect and examine myself and just take more time to be alone with God and to read and to pray. I believe that God has given us an opportunity in the season in which we're living right now to get closer to him and to understand both who we are in Christ and to better understand who God is towards us. I believe that during this time, we'll have the opportunity to see how God is faithful and he continues his faithfulness towards us as he provides and takes care of us, even during this turmoil. But I believe that we'll have an opportunity during this season as well to examine ourselves and to take an inventory of maybe some of the things that lack in our lives and some of the things that maybe we need more of in our relationship with Jesus Christ. And so my call to all of us tonight, beginning with myself and those of you who will watch this video clip, is will you devote yourself in this season, however difficult it is, will you devote yourself to getting deeper in your relationship with God? Will you devote yourself to a deeper study of Scripture, a deeper prayer life, a deeper fellowship, a deeper communication with Jesus, only to discover in the end who he really is and who you are in light of Christ's finished work? Like the disciples, we can have not only peace, but we can have joy, because the Bible says that when they saw Jesus, they were glad. And really, when we see him for who he is in the most turbulent times, we can experience gladness, we can experience joy, we can experience peace, but our eyes need to be focused on him during this time. So I want to conclude my thoughts just with a couple of verses from Scripture that I think are foundational for all of us. And they're taken from the Epistle to the Hebrews in chapter 12. In verse 1 and verse 2, the Bible says as follows, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God." What a wonderful verse. I just want to take a couple of minutes and pray. Father, I come before you tonight, Lord, knowing that you are still sovereign, knowing that you are in control, and nothing takes you by surprise, Lord. Father, I'm praying that if there's anybody watching this video clip tonight or any other day, Father, I pray that, Lord, they would be reminded of the fact that you are alive, that you died, you rose again, Jesus, and you are alive, and you are at the right hand of the Father. And I pray, God, that we would set our sights, our focus on you and your finished work, Lord, because that is the source of our peace. It's knowing that we are justified. It's knowing that we are cleansed and forgiven. It's knowing that we are redeemed and adopted into the family of God. It's knowing that we have a place in your kingdom and we have an inheritance. And God, we have been anointed and sealed by your Spirit, Lord. And I thank you for all of those blessings. Let us not forget during this time who we are. Let us not forget who you are, Lord. And God, help us to draw near to you and discover the peace that surpasses all understanding. For we know that it's available to those who set their heart on looking to you and following you, Lord. I pray, God, if there are burdens, if there are sicknesses, if, Lord, there's any kind of lack of peace, there's pain. Lord, if there's fear of the future, fear of failure, Lord, fear of sickness, whatever that those may be, Father, I pray that they would be driven out and removed, Lord, and that your peace would settle in, that your presence, God, would be a reality in the lives of your people, a palpable reality. Lord, I pray all this in the wonderful and the beautiful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We love you, Lord. Amen. God bless you.